Stephen Marcus and Sperry Andrews, that's this one's name, are presenting a visceral experience that allows for the integration of our mind-made conceptual version of what is non-verbally sensed and felt by each of us and both of us together by pointing your attention with ours to what is noticeable in the moment as it's happening, inclusive of what is constant and unchanging, the mirror-like, receptive, reflective awakeness that is formless and choiceless, that is the goal of all meditation and contemplation, is to become awake to that which is constant, the only constant in the whole of consciousness, so that what does change, the sensory motor reptilian sensory intelligence and the heartfelt emotional limbic system of what we have evolved through as being mammals, function together non-verbally to be noticed by the new brain, this childlike left brain that is trying to make a conceptual equivalent of what is non-verbally sensed and felt by us individually, as well as indivisibly at a collective level, which seems to be the promise of nature for the whole of humanity to ultimately realize how to share a commonly sensed, wholly heartfelt conscious intelligence as a species on this planet. And as Thierry de Chardin has observed, bring fire to earth for the second time, that when humanity has harnessed the powers of love, we will have this awakening and an enlightened society on this planet where we're not in conflict with ourselves or one another, and we can realize what is most important in every moment as 8 billion or more people living together in was sensitive to the ecosystem of the planet so that we're not destroying it. And so this opportunity to experientially explore this together also has a physics component of it, because that is the language in which we can point more precisely than in any other language to the structure of consciousness itself, and how we can actually comprehend how the whole of nature is incomparably unique every moment. Why it has been that we individually can feel lost in the forest among the trees, by way of saying it, because there is an infinite recreation of creation that is incomparably unique every moment. And when we try to grip a hold of anything in this field of infinite complexity, we're just grappling, trying to grip a hold of straws that fall from our hands and don't give us any security, where the Eastern mystics have, like Gautama Buddha and Lao Tzu and Shankara and, you know, the Hindu religion, have all recommended that it all boils down to awareness becoming aware of itself. And when awareness can become conscious of itself and be structured by itself, by anchoring itself in itself, then the whole relative, ever-changing body, heart, and mind feels secure. And there's a sense of being, of well-being, a sense of self-awareness, shared awareness in relationship, shared sensitivity to life and others and ourselves in a way that feels absolutely safe and survivable. And so we're going to experientially explore this, Stephen and I, here with you today. So, Stephen, would you like to take us into it, step by step, descending into our
community? Thanks, Corey.
You're welcome.
As I feel into this emergence on this space that is holding Stephen and Sperry and that meeting point, maybe it's partly triggered by the images behind you of the ocean, but there's a feeling of, although when I look at that image, it's as if I'm looking from a distance, but there's a feeling of immersion in a sort of watery space, and that there's a warmth there, and there's a welcome that's neither you nor I, but it's there's something arising that's saying, yes, come, or it feels that there's also emotional things, like there's a feeling of joy in being there and in sharing this. You mentioned about the physics, and I'm wondering how that could help us to move deeper into this experience from this first place.
Having spent the better part of a lifetime since 4 years old through an NDE where this body and heart and mind did not exist anymore. There was no me, no mind, no self. There was just boundless awakeness that had no form, that seemed to be undergirded by a void that was giving rise to the light of consciousness, which was the only constant. And it was very, very peaceful to not be someone grappling with sentient existence at the level of form, but instead to be formless consciousness. And when coming back into this one's four-year-old body, asking the question of, why did this one need to have this experience, before the question was even finished being asked, this one was shown how the whole of nature fluctuates in and out of formlessness and back into form as a way of sustaining this evolutionary consciousness, where all the cells and atoms and molecules that make everything up are reassociated with each other in some fresh and new way, and how this is the backbone of the life force. And so this one has spent one's entire life trying to understand how to communicate about this in a language that the military, industrial, political, medical establishment could actually recognize. Not a simple task, but gratefully, the answer to what consciousness is has been found and shared with my collaborator of 6 years, who's a professor of physics for 35 years and is one of the most outstanding theoretical physicists and scientific historians that I really searched for without knowing who it would be, but felt somehow instinctually that there must be such a person. And from a very young age, this one sought out eminent scientists from all the various fields of research science in order to see if there might be others who could help humanity understand to take the next step towards species-wide enlightenment on this planet so we could be free of suffering together. So in the physics of this, right now, we can notice that there is that which is this silent, still, constant. It's like a mirror, like the two-dimensional screen of Zoom video here, where Stephen's three-dimensional presence and mine are united, like on a mirror-like surface. Susskind at Stanford, one of the top physicists, theoretical physicists in the world, has shown over the last few years how we can simplify the complexity of three dimensions by showing how it can all be represented on a two-dimensional surface, the two-dimensional surface of a black hole, for example, which is a spherical surface, but it is nonetheless two-dimensional. Now, these are very complex and unfamiliar ideas to most people, but this clip is really meant and designed to interest those who have a more advanced scientific understanding. So this translation from our three-dimensional experience as human beings of Stephen's and mine and yours to this two-dimensional surface that we're sharing in this audiovisual clip is a contemplative candle flame, if you will, in our meditation together, so that we can focus in and become aware of how constant and consistent the quality of our awakeness, that aspect of awareness, which is imageless and free of all thought and content, that is just receiving and reflecting like a mirror receives and reflects without any image of its own. Now, in physics terms, we've come to understand how the void, most of the most advanced theoretical physicists and cosmologists agree that the universe that we have could only have arisen from nothing whatsoever. So we have Alex Vilenkin and Alan Guth and quite a few other physicists that all agree that this universe could arise from absolutely nothing whatsoever. So Dr. James E. Beekler, who's my collaborator, and myself have explored how the universe could arise from nothing whatsoever and enter into this evolutionary progression and expansion and arrive at this very moment that we share here together right now. So just give a brief overview of that. Notice and contemplate and imagine what is unimaginable. It's a very humorous request that a void is not a thing. It has no boundary. That's what this one experienced in this one's NDE at 4. There was no beginning or end to what could not begin and cannot end. That which cannot be divided against itself, because there is no thing to divide, has all these very exceptional, amazing properties, which are all constant. And in physics, we look for constants, for our mathematical equations to comprehend how can form be orchestrated and organized and deconstructed and reconstructed and represented to itself through this present moment, eternal now, which is the observer, essentially, of what there is to observe, what there is to measure, what there is to perceive and feel and sense and think about and contemplate together. So you can see how this is the complexity of this, just at an experiential level, really challenges us to stretch, which, of course, evolution has caused us to stretch in order to survive, not be eaten by a predator or whatever. We've had to adapt to our environmental conditions, who's our neighbors, and who do we need to eat in order to survive? And ultimately, we realize that we can actually use a complex field of resonance to nurturify everything that we need. We don't actually need to feed upon plants and animals. It's quite an extraordinary step in health technology, and we can actually keep ourselves well and eliminate all dysfunction from our genome, and by treating us as a plasma field in these, what people are calling med beds, and that we can cultivate a telepathic somatic intelligence as a species, as some other off-planet civilizations have done, and actually share a commonly sensed, wholly embodied consciousness with billions of other people, so that our neurophysiological psychology is maturing at a much higher rate, and with the result of being able to mutually understand what there is to understand as billions of people evolving and maturing together as a sentient species in this cosmos, where there are, by latest count, about 2 trillion galaxies, which obviously there must be many more if that's what we can observe, each of them with 100 to 200, 300 billion suns and countless planets that could support sentient life. And so that many of them may be far in advance of us, even billions of years in advance of us. And there's appears to be evidence of them having visited us and actually tinkered with us for hundreds of thousands of years. So these are very controversial topics, yet there is more evidence of this, and we're all exploring it experientially and emotionally and physically and intellectually and socially together here in this contest, essentially, for our own survival, so that we can survive ourselves, our own ignorance and innocence.
As you share that, there's an awareness of the void-like nature of human consciousness, in the sense of there is no outside of it. All that's being experienced is experience, and anything new that seems new or fresh that comes in is inside experience, and there's no external validation of any of that. And so as I allow these words to come, as we are exploring the articulation, the words, the effort to describe brings me deeper into the experience, not to find some answer, but to actually be exploring this void-like space that sort of has the illusion of content and consciousness in it. What's coming up right now is having seen some of your work and the zero dimensional points and how that here, as I've heard you speak about that. I'm not a physicist, so I can't use it as something that makes sense of some theory, but there's some place in me that says, yes, this is what holds or explains something in a whole new way. And so I'm interested in this moment, as if you could elaborate on that, if that may take us, or you know, what I'm experiencing right now. There's not so much me observing you, that there's some sort of unfoldment in this space that is still including bright suns and oceans, but it's more of a, it's coming in as a feeling sense of this joyful, warm inclusion. It's joyful, warm, fluid, but not actually wet or watery. It's a space that has ripples, and it's like, it'd be like an ocean, but it's made up of light and waves of energy and consciousness. And there's a sort of surrendering and dissolving into it, and there's an excitement about just leaning in and diving in deeper. So yeah, since this encounter we're having is connected with physics, how does zero dimensions enrich this, or enrich?
So yes, thank you, Stephen. So let's imagine that a dimensionless point, which is the foundation of three-dimensional geometry, it's a bunch of dimensionless points serving as coordinate locations that are seemingly separate from each other at different ever-varying distances, between which there are fields and force, a field that has forces like gravitation and electromagnetic forces, strong and weak nuclear forces, depending on what depth we're looking at. But in its essence, every coordinate location in the what is called the geometrodynamics of three-dimensional physics, every single dimensionless point is said to share a single polar point. So imagine all the dimensionless points that make up three dimensions. There's more of them than there is anything else in this universe. But they are nothing whatsoever. They are still the void. They are like the void. They are not a thing. They're just an unchanging, constant, what we talk about as a location. But we have to consider that the void is a location when we consider how all dimensionless points in the whole of three dimensions in the entire universe are instantaneously indivisible at a single dimensionless point, which is still the void, still undivided from the void. And since the void cannot be divided against itself, and there's no thing to divide, this one single constant, which is dimensionless, actually holds the whole of the cosmos together, and it causes the whole cosmos to be localized at every and through every dimensionless point simultaneously in the entire universe that is unified as a verse that is being deconstructed and reconstructed and represented to itself omnipresently and omnipotently, omnisciently, as information, as appearance, as space and time, energy and matter, mind and body, now that we're here. So this recreation of creation, said we're made in the image of our creator, we are recreating creation by observing it right now. We are that constant mirror-like, receptive, reflective awakeness, which has no image of its own, which is the only constant in the whole of consciousness, which is an eternal now in meditative contemplative experience that we can actually enter into and share more readily and more completely together, because the magnitude of our combined consciousness is more capable of noticing what is noticeable about the noticing that we are sharing, and revealing to us that what we could metaphorically call the sentence of life, where there's a noun and then there's an object in the sentence of life that the noun is seeking or acting upon, through the verb, through the activities of feeling and sensing and thinking and knowing and unknowing and seeing and smelling and hearing and tasting and sharing. So right now, even thinking is, it's also a verb. If we look at thinking right now, experientially, we can see that the verb thinking is not identified with any given thought. It's processing any given noun or what that noun may result in or have causal affect upon or effect of on the object of the sentence of life, that the noun and the object of the sentence of life have to be constantly changing, never the same way twice. So they are active, and it's very exciting to be a noun, to be Sperry, to be Stephen, to be you, to be anyone, to be everyone, to be all that is, every bug and leaf and creature on the planet. It's very thrilling that there is this continuous renewal through the life force that is brought about through the activity of the verbs, which is, it's like a rolling boil when we boil water, that the water that's being most heated at the bottom of the pot closest to the flame is heated more than the water at the top. And so the water rises to the top and as bubbles and so forth, and then returns back to the bottom to be reheated. Well, that's what the nouns are going through. So they're being regenerated, and the bubbles in the heated water, of course, are no bubbles. They're not the same bubbles. They are fresh and new every moment. That's what makes life so miraculous and entertaining. Life makes us as when we come in as little babies, as being fresh and new and innocent. We know that we don't know who or what we are. We're completely ignorant, and yet we're lit up and turned on and absolutely delighted by being fresh and new every moment. And yes, we can cry if we get hurt or we feel objectified by our caregivers as good little girl, good little boy, eat your oatmeal. No, that's your sister's toy. Give it back to your sister. And we begin to be objectified as separate. And at some visceral level, we understand that we can't really survive and thrive very well if we're treated and conceiving of ourselves as only a separate object. Mm-hmm. So we have to integrate the noun that we are and the verb that we are so that they can coexist amicably together with our caregivers. And our parents often of our generation didn't really realize any of this. They just said, well, I'm a mommy now, or I'm a daddy, and this is my baby, and it's my baby, and I'm going to be now accorded the respect and dignity of being a mother or being a father in my society with friends and neighbors. And, you know, when I look at myself in the mirror, I say, yes, I am the mother or the father of this baby, and this baby is XYZ with this label, this name. And, you know, I gave birth to this baby, me, 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 me. And so we have this whole world broken down into nouns, but we have to explore experientially getting back to this mirror-like awakeness, which is transpersonal. It's not me or you or this or that. It is an activity of alive, awake consciousness that is the only constant in the whole of consciousness, which, as Eckhart Tolle would say, it is the joy of being consciousness together that is this communion of unity, of love, that we're all starving for. And if we would just notice in an undivided way together and get over ourselves, we could actually embody the whole of life, even though it would take a lot of stretching and a lot of, you know, deconditioning of all our habit, you know, piecemeal sequential ways of clinging and avoiding and running away from what we don't want towards what we think we do want. We have to overcome all of those addictive habit patterns, which are very powerful. They demand that we repeat them. So only by getting to what is formless and silent within us and noticing it together and finding strength in what we are, can we anchor ourselves in the groundless ground of our being, as the great and famous, world-famous psychologist Carl Jung said in a single sentence, paraphrasing him, in the process of maturation, the individual ultimately realizes that they're indivisible from everyone and everything. And when more of us realize this, we have a chance of having a conscious civilization on this planet. So realizing that we're this dimensionless void, which was uncreated, it's uncaused, it's unborn, as they say in the East, as the Gautama Buddha and even the Dalai Lama quite recently, he said, it's not about getting rid of the self, it's about realizing that the self never existed in the first place. So this is very challenging for the, you know, like America, for example, which many cultures came to in order to have religious freedom. Everybody could practice their own individual belief systems. And America has become this melting pot where everybody is losing their cultural identity, instead creating a common cultural identity, which is consumerism, like who's got what, who doesn't have what? What do you look like? Do you look prettier or not as pretty as the next person? Do I want you or someone else to be my friend or be my enemy or be somebody who I want to shun and avoid? And so we have this polarization, which has reached its apogee today on planet Earth. And the power elite are utilizing that to divide us against ourselves and each other for political power. And, you know, just as in nature programs, the bigger shark or crocodile is going to dominate its ecosystem. And in fact, the parasite, the predator, the primary predator in each ecosystem, if there weren't a predator, there would not have been much evolution. And this has been shown in a wonderful film where when the predators were removed from various ecosystems, they didn't flourish. They remained flatlined in their evolution, which is okay too. But as we wake up together and predator and prey realize that they don't have to predate and be prey for each other, that we can transcend that to a higher level of sensitivity and consciousness, that in our health industry, our technologies, and our social institutions, our spiritual understanding that all is one single whole, undivided, accept our void-like nature that is omnipresent and acting and orchestrated and organized through every dimensionless point in three dimensions. This is a huge step that we are all right on the verge of taking together. So I'll leave it there for you, Stephen.
Just letting all of that land, and one of the thoughts that came up was, as you were talking about the void and the zero dimensional point, was sort of comparing it with T.S. Eliot's the still point of the turning world from his from his four quartets. And there was a realization that this sort of goes beyond that, because as I take in, there's a sort of like searching, where is this still point of the turning world where there's nothingness? And it's like, oh, it's everywhere, and it's nowhere as well. That there's, it has all those qualities that he talks about very, very richly and fully in that poem, and yet it's not something that can be sought anywhere or reached towards, because it's actually, there's this very ordinary emptiness that's there and that's in all things. And I've been mentioning a lot about this sort of fluid space that your imagery was drawing me into. And there was like, it's not a contrast of this void and that. It's like going into this space, which somehow feels like it sort of includes you and I, and yet is neither and is everything. And it's in going into that and sort of almost allowing a dissolving to happen, that I'm coming deeper, that this is coming, pronouns don't really work here. It's this experience of voidness, that it comes, maybe as I was saying earlier, that it's sort of by trying to use words to describe the indescribable, that we come deeper into the experience of the indescribable. And so, there's thoughts and words of somehow just allowing to go into this oceanic space, and it's going into that and through that, that there's access to this experience of nothing, and of through that of everything. It actually feels like a great luxury not to need to even try to make sense, just to be able to use words as a tool for, like, it's like water. It's like you can't grab the hold of the ocean. It's like swimming through it, moving it aside, and in that moving and swimming, sort of moving forward.
Yes,
breathing that in. Yeah.
Oh, excuse me.
Yeah.
Jiddu Krishnamurti was considered by the Theosophical Society to be coming the second coming of Christ, who disbanded the order of the star, so to speak, saying, no, there's no leader. Each of us has to discover the truth for ourselves, and that that in embracing our suffering in an undivided way, without trying to escape it, our suffering turns from being a river that is pulling us along, that we find that that river enters the ocean of consciousness, and we experience our oceanic nature, and we become free of suffering by realizing that which cannot be divided against itself, as consciousness, formless consciousness or thoughtless awareness, as some would say, the absence that is giving rise to our presence. So as you said, Stephen, it's like there's these two seeming opposites of form and formlessness cannot be divided from one another. So if this is form and this is formlessness, and is said they are one without a second, so that without formlessness, form would not be able to have these independent digits moving relative to each other as independent elements in a single whole. Form depends upon formlessness for the capacity to have conscious awareness within every atom and molecule and cell, to unite all the other atoms and molecules and cells as a functional whole. So form needs formlessness in order to be functional as a living, evolving, fresh and new form of life that is being represented to itself every instant, continuously, not incrementally, but continuously. That's how amazing this universe is at the level of physics. Now, without form, formlessness would be absolutely nothing at all. There would be. So it's when form and formlessness are united as a single indivisible whole, these absolute opposites, there's a phase transition like between water and ice or water and gas, phase transition between formlessness and form is consciousness. Consciousness is that which unites two things in an awareness, in an awakeness that is can be contemplated perceptually, experientially in a fully embodied way. So the phase transition that is occurring in each of you listening and feeling and sensing with us here, and what Stephen and I are experiencing, that we are this phase transition between form and formlessness. And this is part of the neurophysiological psychology of self-awareness that links with the inseparable, indivisible physics, which is an eternal now, which scientists have agreed, you know, by and large, they say, we don't know what the eternal now is or why there is this space in which we all coexist. I mean, can you imagine that contemporary science can't explain until like Jim Buechler and I came along and said, we both have understood how to explain the eternal now and how what consciousness is and how life has progresses and evolves as space, time, energy, and matter, mind, and body through this dimensionless pivot point, which is the observer. Now, in the physics of Einstein, Jim did his PhD dissertation in Einstein. And he's one of the most outstanding scientific historians. He can tell you what everybody realized and talked about and exchanged with the people that inherited their knowledge and insight and wisdom through a progression going back thousands of years from Hinduism and even before that to whatever we can have record of right up into the present day. He can show who understood what and didn't, what they didn't understand, and how the next people came along and they made it possible to take the next step. Now, Einstein was advised by Kaluza and Klein and James Clerk Maxwell, who had discovered the electromagnetic research and was one of those brilliant people. William Clifford, who died very young, but he's absolutely outstanding in his understanding of the geometry of space-time. And Louis de Broglie, who said all particles share a single singularity. All these people who were, realizing this, when it came to the Solvay conference and Einstein was put in, had come up with special and general relativity, as I recall, at that point, he wanted to possibly make the fourth dimension a dimension of space rather than a dimension of time, because of these other people's work who said, if you don't have a fourth dimension of space, you can't even have rotation or centripetal or centripodal action. You have to make up fake forces to explain them. But because of the conservative element from Ernst Mach, they said, if you can't measure it, it's not about, you can't observe it, then it shouldn't belong as a part of physics. And so they eliminate what was immeasurable. And ironically enough, the fourth dimension of space is dimensionless. It cannot be divided against itself. It makes the whole of three dimensions indivisible. It serves as the observer of three dimensions. It is not confined to the speed of light of, you know, 300,000 kilometers a second or 186,000 miles per second as the speed of light. It is a continuous, indivisible aspect of what we experience as things and thoughts and activities that are separated sequentially over, millions, billions of years as the explication of form, as an ever accelerating expansion of this three-dimensional cosmos, which we find so miraculous and amazing that we're a sentient version of. Our so-called 3-pound universe, where we have localized the non-local universe through perceptual activity, we say that the brain is a 3-pound universe. It has been created over hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years. Now, even worms and small little fish have a neocortex. So the little fish can say, do I want to be eaten by this bigger fish? No, I'm a smaller thing. I think I could fit in that crack in the rock over there, and then I won't be eaten, and I could live to tell about bigger fish who try to eat you with my progeny so that maybe they can escape being predated by other fish. So we're in a process of evolution, perceptual evolution, that has allowed us to arrive at this moment together. And we can survive our own ignorance and inane insanities as individuals who are indivisible with each other. And it seems like an insurmountable challenge that we face together to bring about a commonly sensed, wholly heartfelt conscious intelligence as a single species of diverse individuals who are all ultimately able to experience our indivisibility as a single heartfelt consciousness, as all loving, as mutually supportive and respectful of our differences, of our diversity as a unity. So what do you say, Stephen?
Well, as you were describing this 3-pound, whatever it is, 20 or 30 centimeter universe, there was also a taking in and the big universe, this one that's about four times as big in terms of, you know, light years as it is old. In other words, even however powerful a telescope we were ever to produce, we could only be able to see up to a certain point, and beyond that there'd be space, places where the light would never come to us. And yet in this dimension that we're connected even to the furthest reaches of that. My mind's going, huh? But something's landing there about, including, I've forgotten how big the universe is, 70 or 80 billion light years across, isn't it? Something like that.
Yes, they went from about 13.7 or to it's over 14 billion years old. That's just the radius. So it's at least 28 billion light years across, and in its diameter at this point.
that's the bubble that we can see,
yeah,
that we could possibly see with the most powerful telescopes. But I believe that it's, at least in some theories, it's bigger than that. And there's a feeling of, even if it is, there's a connection with that space that's beyond where the light could ever come from, and yet it's connected, yet it's again, taking the luxury of not needing to make sense. There's a feeling of something landing from what you're sharing that's including everything and completely empty at the same time. This void that's
I'd love to share that when I first, at the New School of Social Research in New York City, where I was studying physics with other subjects, and it was first really wondered, like, okay, well, what is beyond the light cone of the creation of this form of this universe? And if you could imagine this form-based universe expanding at the speed of light, and then beyond that, well, what is that that's beyond that? Well, let's remember that this universe is the void, even though it appears to be space-time, energy, matter, mind, and body. And so this expanding light cone of this universe is meeting formless void, which is then utilized to unite and reunite and reunite space, time, energy, and matter to create more space and time, energy, and matter out of absolutely nothing whatsoever. And as some say, that this universe is a soul manufacturing facility. We go from being something that is actually nothing, by being so complex and interwoven and self-referencing that we end up what we call a soul, a spirited sentient beings populating this cosmos, all made out of nothing whatsoever, ensured that we do not die, that there is no possibility of death. We are all unborn and immortal. And as it's said in the East, when we realize who we really, what we truly are in life, that when we undergo physical death, that we realize that we, what, who and what we truly are does not die. The physical form falls away, becomes fertilizer for, you know, creatures and plants and bugs and so forth. But the our formless nature, which is orchestrating and organizing all that is in some fresh and new way every moment, and localizing the non-local whole as a form of ensoulment of the whole universe, that we still know that we are nobody going nowhere, but we are also somebody who is incomparably unique, going somewhere that is absolutely amazing, that we can only barely glimpse the miracle of what we are actually causing that would not be happening otherwise because of our own apparent existence. So I'll leave you there, Stephen.
Mm. Yeah. Breathing that in and taking a little pause in silence, I'm curious about what's actually, no, there's no curiosity. There's just this space of isness and there's actually a deep relaxation into it and into not being curious, not trying to find, not trying to change, just letting a sort of landing happen.
To switch back to gallery view, so our audience, who are is us also, can actually experience with us thoughtless awakeness. Thoughtless awareness is what we actually are. And the melting pot of all these religions and cultures has left us grappling with the unknown. Yet we are that which is unknowable, because there's no thing to know. And that's where the freedom is. And that's what the East has been saying through thousands of years of meditative contemplation, is that there is, as Namkhai Norbu wrote 22 books, was one of the most venerated Tibetan scholars. People made centers for him around the world in the hope that he would come and visit them. He said, we're all the void, whether we know it or not. And it's this avoidance of the void which is the issue, the pivotal issue for humanity. And we've through all that we've contemplated verbally and sensorially and emotionally, you and I together here, we're actually beautifully arriving in thoughtless awakeness, where there's no self. And yet we are incomparably unique in ways that we can't even imagine. We can't comprehend who or what we are at the level of form, because it's too vast, it's too complex. And so we find the PEACE and all the many puzzle pieces that are so puzzling just effortlessly can fall into place as they will to make up a bigger picture that we all can share together.
Thank you. Since I had been hot on the watery metaphors this evening, I'll just end on a rather mundane one that's coming up. And it's that experience when you're in a hot tub and you've got all the jets and motors on, and then at some point they turn off. And it seems like almost like all the words that we've been using and exploring this evening are like those jets and bubbles and things. And when it stops, there's this,
So what can become obvious to each and all of us is that we're everybody, we're everything, we're anyone, we're someone, we're no one, we're nobody going nowhere, we're everybody and somebody going everywhere, forever, all at once, every instant, in this timeless, eternal now. Does that feel real to you, Stephen?
Yeah.
Well, shall we say thanks for joining us and in this exploration of experiential sensitivity,
thank you.
Without it having to mean anything at all, we have nurtured our left brain, our conceptualizing child that's trying to catch up with our reptilian father and mammalian mother, heartfelt mother, who cares about us. Being able to focus that which is no thing whatsoever, more precisely like a magnifying glass, focuses the sunlight to create the ignition of of fire. This is the fire of consciousness that is being ignited by our being able to come into focus together.